Okay. I tend to wander around when I'm talking, so I'll probably walk in front of the slides quite a lot, but there's not a vast amount on the slides, so you won't be missing anything if you can't see them. So I'm Assistant Director for Infrastructure at York, and before that I was Information Security Specialist. That was sort of my background. Before that I did some maths. And now in my current team, I have the people that install and upgrade and run our student records systems. That's sort of our information systems. So we basically, there's two assistant directors at York. My colleague Andrew Mayle, his team does the software development and the integration. And for this audience, mine does the upgrades and runs the databases and everything else. So in my previous life, doing security, I'd look at all these business systems and go, oh my God, they're all awful. Why don't they just upgrade them all? And now I look at them and go, oh my God, they're all awful. Why don't we? No, no, let's not. So let's think of some more practical things to do. Is this going to work? Where do I need to? Before we think about the current state, though, we need to look at history. Now, anyone that was here this morning with the guy who was telling us how Amazon did things said they don't like PowerPoint because PowerPoint allows you to allied facts to sell. So just be aware, I'm completely going to do that in this section, okay? This is a very biased take on the history of hacking on the internet. It's not completely untrue, though, and I think the trends and the points are hopefully valid. So a few technical definitions, just so we're all working with the same thing. Some words that you're undoubtedly familiar with and you probably know, but just to make sure. So a computer virus is some code that makes some other code, a program, an operating system, something, do something that the authors didn't want it to do or didn't expect it to do. Okay, so a virus that infects Windows is making Windows do something that Microsoft didn't want it to do. But to spread, it requires human action. So you visit a web page, you click on a link, you do something. Okay? And then a worm is a self-replicating virus. So it doesn't require that final step of the human interaction. You get it on one computer, it spreads to others. Okay? And then finally, malware is just malicious software. And the distinction between malware and a virus is that malware can pretty much, it doesn't necessarily make some other bit of software do it. It can just be malicious in itself. And I think the canonical example is probably browser toolbars. If any of you have tried to help your parents debug their Internet Explorer when it had a list of toolbars this big and like a viewpoint like that at the bottom, that software wasn't a virus as such. It was operating as intended. It was using the interfaces provided. It's just that it was doing it for malicious reasons. So I've got to work out where to point this. So let's go back to 1988. So this guy is Robert Morris Jr., who was, I think, a system administrator on sort of the early internet. So he's in America. The internet at that time was very small. Most UK universities were not connected to the global internet, apart from UCL, I think. And it was mainly academics and a few military sites. So Robert Morris wanted to work out how big the internet was. So how do you work out how big it is? It got big enough that you couldn't just look it up as you could have done 10 years ago. So he wrote some code that exploited a vulnerability in Unix systems, which were the most common thing on the internet at the time. It would infect a system. It would then scan further and infect more systems. So it was the first worm. And there's an obvious problem with a worm, which is that you go, you infect one system, you infect another. How do you stop it coming back again and infecting the other one? So he wrote, part of the code was that it shouldn't reinfect the same system twice. But he got it wrong. And so this thing spread around pretty much the full extent of the then existing internet and then kept spreading and reinfecting and crashed the whole lot just by volume of compute. So he basically crashed the entire internet. He then had to go and talk to his dad, because he was a young guy at the time. His dad, Robert Morris Sr., was director of the National Security Agency, which is... So it was a little unfortunate. He got away with community service and went on to found a company called ViaWeb, made a load of money, is now an academic. So you wouldn't get that sort of slap on the wrist now if you crashed the entire internet. But it's a nice example because it just shows the world was very, very, very different. There you go. And what were the rest of us doing that weren't connected to the internet? Well, if you remember these things, these sort of, you know, 3D printed save icons that we have here, you had to take one of these and put it in your computer, and if it had a virus on it, it would spread to your computer. And that's where the sort of analogy of a virus came from. You're physically taking it, putting it in. And what did it do? Well, if they'd had irony and internet memes back in the 80s, you might have done something like this. It would corrupt your disk, it would show you a pretty picture, it would say, I am great for the author, or something not too... Yeah, might lose some data if you were unlucky, mainly if the author had made a mistake. But there was no way of making money out of this. You know, there was no Bitcoin. Someone puts a virus into a PC that's not on the internet anyway. How are you ever going to know as the author? So it was just all for fun, for laughs and for griefing. But then we get to the early 2000s. So by this point, see, we're all on the internet. All our systems are now dependent on it. And these things came along. That's actually really hard to read. That says Code Red. So anyone that was around in the 2000s, these were two worms that spread on Microsoft Windows systems. So at the time, Microsoft was making very, very insecure systems. They didn't really care about security. They cared about getting product out the door and crushing the opposition. And they were really, really good at that. But this prompted a massive change because all of a sudden, all their customers went, wait a minute, you mean we can just be hacked and we can just have all our systems crash? This isn't acceptable. And Bill Gates wrote a famous memo to the company that just said, security is now our priority number one. And it started a long trend of fixing their operating systems from sort of 95 to ME to NT, 2000. So with the state we're at now, well, Windows is actually, core Windows is one of the most secure operating systems you can run. So the worms sort of died out, really. Operating systems got more secure, we all put in firewalls, we all put in antivirus, and there were easier ways to make money. And that's what starts to come in. It starts to become about making money. And how do you make money? Well, we'll get back to that. But what we did do, so we slowly harden our operating systems. They're still not massively secure at this point. So this is a website, ltsn.york.ac.uk in 2005. It was hacked because websites were new. We were all putting them in. Random academics were putting them in. They were all woefully insecure. It's possibly a little hard to tell, but there's a face there looking up at a Turkish flag. And that's all the attackers did. They broke in, they replaced the homepage with this image, and then they moved on. Again, you couldn't really monetize it. You got the odd person trying. They'd ring up and they'd say, your website's been hacked. Would you like some security consulting to help you fix it? Yes. And I'm sure there was state-level espionage and maybe commercial espionage, but none of that really touched the university sector. Or if it did, we certainly didn't notice. But the attacks, you know, sort of shift. And then from there, we get onto the social scam. So you probably can't read this, but I know this will come as a surprise because you do not know me. I am John Allison. I work in the Central Bank of Nigeria Packaging and Courier Department. And, you know, there's a package, it's got lost. The content of the package is $20 million, all in $100 bills, and the company does not know the consignment contains money. And these made lots and lots of money. They were known as 418 scams because they came out of Nigeria. And really, these haven't gone away because we've got better at dealing with them. Well, we've got better at dealing with them. They've gone away because our email providers now filter them and spot them as spam. They haven't gone away because the people that they're being sent to have got any less gullible. But now we get better things. So here's an example. This is one that's targeted to the education sector. It's much more recent. Attached herewith are two documents summarizing your May salary as reviewed for a 13.89% merit increase. Now, we can all spot this as a fake because none of us are going to get a 13.89% merit increase. But actually, the rest of it is quite good. The grammar's good. The English is good. There's some documents that if you click on, you can lose your username and password. So this is, yeah, quite recent. And why bother hacking something when you can just get somebody to send you their stuff anyway? So that sort of brings us very, very, very rapidly through 20-odd years of history. There's still lots and lots of viruses. There's still lots of attacks against web surfing, web software. And there's certainly still lots and lots and lots and lots of phishing. Oh, but then I said worms died out, didn't I? Except they didn't. So we're going to come back to this is WannaCry. lots of in the news. Famous for the NHS in this country, but actually it affected an awful lot of institutions. This is a German train announcement screen at a station that tells you what platform your train is and when it's due. And obviously this, it says it's in German, please send us some bitcoins to get your computer back. So that's the almost the final evolution. These crypto lockers, things that encrypt your data, send us some bitcoins. We've created this nice worldwide anonymous-ish money system. And so now you can make money doing this sort of thing. And that move from what at the start was just a researcher that tried to find out how big the internet was to trying to make money is really what defines the threat landscape over this period. So my argument is going to be that basically the worry is, how do people make money out of you? So how do you scope that? How do you make that relevant to your life as an administrator of a system? Yeah, you've got this, oh, there's lots of badness on the internet. How's that relevant to my student records system? Okay. And that's what threat modeling as a discipline tries to do. You can read big fat books on threat modeling. There's lots and lots of detail. This doesn't attempt to be comprehensive. It's just a sort of a real starter. But again, we need to know some more terminology. So three things. First of all, a vulnerability. A vulnerability is a weakness that makes a target susceptible to attack. So a bug in software, if you like. But it doesn't have to be a technical weakness. Okay. If I ring you up and I say, I'm the Vice Chancellor, give me £1 million, and you just give me £1 million, or if you would have done, that is a vulnerability. And it's not a technical one. Okay, a threat, an effect that might damage or compromise an asset or an objective, objective in the sense of from the attacker here. It may or may not be malicious in nature. So the original Morris worm was not malicious, but it was certainly a threat because it crossed your system. And finally, an attack, an action taken against a target with the intention of doing harm. Okay. So you can have a vulnerability for a very long time and it won't cause you any problems whatsoever, until you've got a threat and then somebody attacks it. Okay, so it's picking out those different bits. So OWASP is a web security group. OWASP.org is a great site. They've got vast amounts of detailed technical stuff on web development. They also have sort of policy stuff, threat modeling stuff, all sorts of good stuff. So this is their definition, and I really like this definition. So threat modeling is a procedure for optimizing security by identifying objectives and vulnerabilities and defining countermeasures. And I think it's worth just unpacking that quite a lot, actually. So first of all, it's a procedure for optimizing security. It's not a procedure for making yourself secure, okay? You're never going to be secure. What you can say is, I am secure against a certain threat. So if you buy a fireproof safe, it's not fireproof. It's fireproof against a certain heat of fire for a certain time, okay? And you buy the safe that matches what you think the fire might be and matches the value of the stuff that you're going to put inside that safe. So next, you're going to identify objectives. So what do you have that people want to steal, okay? What are the vulnerabilities? How will they steal them? And then you define some countermeasures. But you can only define the countermeasures once you've done all this stuff up front. Otherwise, it doesn't really make any sense. There we go. So part of that is to say, OK, somebody wants to attack me. So let's just think about this bit. Who are the threat actors? So when the Democratic emails were leaked in the US election, Donald Trump said it was probably some 400-pound hacker in his mum's basement. And that's both a stereotype and a truth. They might not weigh £400, but the individual person, the loner, that might be trying to make some money, or they might just be having fun, do exist. Okay? Generally lower skilled, and certainly there's only so much skill any one person can have. So as a, you know, when you're thinking about the skill of these group of attackers, even if the individual is very good, you can't know everything. This was the cheesiest bit of clip art I could find on the internet for, it was a hot fork contest as well, for criminal hackers. So it's the next step up. Now we're trying to make money, but it's a group of people. And especially in places, for example, Eastern Europe, or Russia, these groups can be very well tolerated, so they don't particularly have to hide, which makes their life a lot easier. So somewhere like Russia, as long as you don't hack within Russia, and you probably pay the appropriate bits of money back to the appropriate people, you're good to go. Because what makes the individuals less effective is that you can't easily communicate. You can email anybody, but you don't know if they're a police informer or anything else. Whereas these guys potentially can just work like a normal business. Smallish business, but a normal business. So they can build resources, they can share knowledge, they can develop toolkits, they can have lists of attackers and objectives, and probably even have HR meetings and all the rest if they really, really wanted. And then finally, we get to the sort of the glamorous end of things, you know, the nation state hacking. And I think, again, I think this is worth talking about for a little while, just because it's the bit that gets all the news and all the press and all the publicity. So who's we are? So we've got the NSA. They've got a budget running into the billions of dollars per annum. If the NSA want to hack you, you're going to have a really, really, really bad time. Russians? Again, major player, maybe not quite as resourced as the NSA, but they're certainly usually regarded as pretty equivalent, pretty skilled. Fortunately, they probably don't want to hack your university. You know, Vladimir Putin has strategic objectives that don't involve breaking into a student record system in a university. They do involve spreading discontent. So the Russians run troll factories where people turn up at work every day and write comments on posts and put links on Twitter. And that might be to promote Donald Trump, it might be to promote Brexit, Catalonian independence. And that all ties into a strategic narrative and a strategic plan that includes things like, say, funding far-left groups. So they link the online and the offline with an intention of fomenting discontent. But yeah, that's a nation-state level problem. It's not really our problem in a university. North Koreans. These guys might be more of a problem. They have a big hacking capability, and they are interested in making money. So they've been linked to the attack on Sony in Japan, which stole a lot of assets and tried to blackmail money out of Japan. They've been linked to attacks against central banks that stole amounts in the tens to the low hundreds of millions of dollars. Because they can't get money any other way. And if you're an international prior anyway, you've got nothing to lose by just stealing it. I mean, yeah, that's what I'd do as well. And finally, who can forget GCHQ? And the reason this is a picture of Boris rather than a picture of Theresa May is that GCHQ in the UK comes under the purview of the Foreign Office. Yeah, oh God, yes, that is the correct answer. So we're all happy, we don't have to worry about any of these people, all right? Not quite so much. So let's go back to WannaCry. There's a reason I picked this set of people. So some number of years ago, we'll probably never know how long, the NSA discovered a vulnerability in Windows. They kept it to one side, they kept it top secret, maybe they used it to attack some top secret targets, who knows, we'll never know. A group called the Shadow Brokers stole that, along with a load of other things, from the NSA. And they put it online in an auction and then just released it publicly. The Shadow Brokers are usually believed to be the Russians. So the Russians hack into the NSA, they steal a load of exploits, and then just publish them. In those exploits were the ones for Windows that WannaCry used, so the ones that allow it to act as a worm and the ones that allowed it to get administrative access once it was on a PC. And again, we'll never know the truth of it unless you work for GCHQ, but there's reasonable evidence that suggests actually this thing came from North Korea. It was an attempt to make money, or maybe an attempt. Or I've also read theories that said it's a Russian false flag operation to try and discredit the North Koreans. I mean, who knows? One of the problems with this stuff is you just can't know. But it caused us a whole bunch of damage. However, the crucial thing to bear in mind is that WannaCry was not targeted at any university. It just spread globally. And if we hadn't patched, which, I won't tell you how many systems we had that weren't patched, it was going to be bad. So we'll come back to that in a minute. But really, I think when you're doing threat modeling, who should you threat model? You want to pick the highest skilled level of attacker that's going to cause you problems, which is basically criminals. Maybe students, but probably not. The things that I would worry about students are people Googling their own name. and finding something that you've made public. So we had a data breach. It's on the ICO's website, so it's not a secret, where our test student record system lost its access control. That was found because a student Googled their student number. There was only one hit, which was that website, and then it spread. Knowledge of that spread through the students, and it got to us about 24 hours later, at which point we switched it off. But students are unlikely to actually hack you maliciously, because you know who they are. There's a lot of consequences that can follow from that. Criminals, yeah, not so much. And if you look at then something on the nation state and they want to cry, actually you don't probably need to think about that as a specific thing, because it's not targeted, it's using what were actually public exploits at the time it was out, and you just need to do the basics to prevent against it. You know, segregate your systems, patch your systems. Slight variant on this. How will you be hacked? The most sophisticated attackers will not use the most sophisticated attack. Okay. So let's say I'm a nation state, I won't say which one. If I drop a bomb on somebody, there's nothing in that action that precludes me dropping another bomb on them later. Okay? I drop a bomb, I can drop another bomb. If I hack into their computers and they detect the attack, it can be patched. And then my attack is useless. So one bomb doesn't become useless because another bomb's been dropped. That can be the case in the cyber warfare. So if the NSA want to hack someone, they're not going to use their top secret zero day. They're just going to probably fish you, get the passwords, and move on. The criminal gangs, the medium-skilled attackers, automated scans, usually they're... If you're trying to make money, you want to go broad, usually. Maybe use known exploits, so malware distribution will generally use known exploits, and if they're not known at the time they first go live with a malware distribution campaign on the web, it'll be known pretty soon afterwards. And finally, the lowest skill level is just using other people's code and Google. But using Google can actually be really effective. Yeah, finding stuff that shouldn't be public is unfortunate a lot of the time. And I like this tweet. If you don't follow Swift on security, Taylor Swift is an InfoSec expert. It's a little known fact, and it's really, really good. So how you think multinational hypercorps get hacked? NSA zero days on the black market. How they actually get hacked? Username of admin, password of admin. And what prompted this was Equifax. So Equifax got hacked, and all that data released. We'll see who that comes down to. My money would be on the Russians, because that was a much more sophisticated attack. But at the same time, in South America, they had a web portal where if I go and apply for a mortgage, employee of the bank can log in, check my credit rating, and then say, no, we're not going to lend you any money. Unfortunately, that web portal was not only public on the internet, but it had a super admin account with the username of admin and the password of admin. So we have to do the basics, and you have to do the basics really well, and doing the basics well actually deters the sophisticated attackers, because then it changes their risk reward. If they have to use a more sophisticated attack to attack you, they are less likely to do so, unless you've got something they really, really, really want, in which case you've got a whole set of other problems. So we're going to digress for a bit. Okay, so what is that practical defense? What sort of things can we look at? Process. If you're in IT, you tend to get bound up in technology. It's not usually the only answer, and it's certainly not all of the answer. So the example I like of this is ATMs. So I go to a cash machine, I put my card in, I say I want 20 quid, it gives me 20 quid. If it's online, it can check my bank balance if it wanted to. What do you do as a bank if a customer goes to an ATM and that ATM is offline and they ask you for money? So you've got two choices. You can give them the money or you can not give them the money. If you give them the money and they don't have the money in their account, then you've lost some money, maybe. If you don't give them the money, you've got an angry customer. So what do you do? And actually what they do is they'll give you money up to a certain value, and they'll limit the amount. So they bound their loss, and you can pick a value that will, you know, account for 95% of withdrawals, and the other people is then smaller, but you've limited your loss. And there's lots of analogies of that we'll come back to when we're thinking about process change. So always think about process when you're doing these threat modeling things. It's not about servers and patching servers. It's about systems and processes and how you handle data and how data flows. Having said which, you do have to patch your systems. I've put here 100% uptime is a bad sign. If you're like us, we have systems that use Oracle at the back end. We've got systems that use MS SQL, and we've got systems that use pretty much everything. But the ones that use Oracle, Oracle is not highly available because we can't afford Oracle Rack. So if those systems have had 100% uptime, it means they haven't been patched. Because we have to take, we've got multiple web servers, multiple application servers, and a single database server at the back. And we have to take the system down to patch it. So we can't have 100% uptime, and we shouldn't. Change all default passwords. Hopefully you all do as part of that. But what do your vendors do? You know, with these business systems, we often get partners in, consultants or the vendors themselves, to come and install the system or do software upgrades. What passwords do they put on? Is it my company name, 123? Quite probably. My current example of this is a vendor that shall remain nameless. It's a cloud bit of software that we are, well, we've just bought. So we did an evaluation as part of the procurement process. We went to them and said, you know, what certifications have you got? What's your software development life cycle? What's your data protection policy? All that sort of stuff. And they came back with glowing answers. So we're like, great, we'll buy it. So come to install. We've got a database on campus. They want to get data up to cloud. So they give us some software that we install on a Windows VM that connects to SQL Server, pulls it, shunts it up to the cloud. Yeah, all the easy stuff. So the team go to install it. And they read the instructions, and it says, create a username, create a user on the SQL Server database with this username and password, and then run the Windows installer. And at no point in this process do you get an option to enter a password. So the password was global across all their customers. So we declined to install their software, and we got back to them and said, look, it's a bit rubbish, guys, what can you do? And they said, oh, yeah, that's a feature request, that'll be 500 quid. Yesterday they've backed down on that and they're now changing it, but the fact that they thought that was an acceptable answer in the first place is shocking. Get your software tested, we'll come back to in a minute. In fact, we'll come back to now. So we talk about developers, we maybe think of people writing Java, but if you're writing, say, SITS code, eVision code, you're a developer. If you're writing within the interfaces that exist in software form development, you are a developer. It's a limited form, but you still have to think about most of the same things. You know, what data are you getting? Are there vulnerabilities? How are you authenticating that? Probably you don't have to worry about it because the application will deal with it. But what am I doing with the data? How am I passing the data? How do I check? All of these things. So it's still worth getting trained in this basis. SDLC is Secure Software Development Lifecycle. If you've got any information security people in the university, get them to come and talk to you for an hour, just about some of the basics. And finally, think about how an attacker will subvert your system, which is what we're going to go back to next. Another good set of basic things, how do you deploy to live? So I said a moment ago that we had this data breach where students found their student records live on the web. That was because back in the day, we deployed, it's a custom bit of code that allowed people to look up student data. It was deployed by the developer, copying it via drag and drop using FTP, not even secure FTP, plain FTP, onto the website. And what happened was they copied the latest version of the app and forgot the access control file, and it defaulted to having no access control. Now that sort of thing really shouldn't happen. So in our new process, you don't do that. You commit the code to source control. It goes to get tests, and some of those tests are, doesn't have any access control, and then the system automatically deploys it to live. So you rule out that human error. Are your test systems secure? This is so common, so common. If you want to break into something, you use the test system. If you lose data, you lose it from the test system. And again, this was a test system we lost data from. If you've had your system pen tested, is it the same as the test system? Because if you do what most of us do and you take copies of your live data and put it into your test system, it has to be the same because it's got the same data in. How are passwords managed? As a rule of thumb, if it's an admin system and you can remember the password, it's rubbish. You should not be able to remember any of your passwords ever. You should have a password management system. You should share that across your team. All passwords should be 24 characters of random gibberish that no one can remember. And there's a lot of benefits to that. It means that when people leave, they won't accidentally, you can't remember the password. Someone might still maliciously steal it, but that's much less of a risk than the fact that people just go and can't forget it. It means the passwords are automatically strong. You stop people having Purple 7 or My Company 123, and especially if you make the vendors do this as well. And it means the passwords are different and actually genuinely different on every system, on every account on every system. Because otherwise what tends to happen is you get Purple 7, Purple 8, Purple 9, variants thereof, you know, that people can remember, so they create the patterns. But if you can remember them, other people can find those patterns out. How are users authenticated? How good is the vendor? Well, I think we've just had an example of that one. But another example, the Equifax breach, the one in the States, was a vulnerability in Java, Java Apache Struts. So we knew one of our vendors used that library, so we rang them up and said, okay, we know you're going to need a bit of time to get this patch. Can you just give us a time frame for when you're going to get the fix out? And their reply was, no, it's fine, because we don't use the version that's got that vulnerability. We use this other version. So we went, looked at that version. It was released in 2005 and was obsoleted in 2005 due to a security flaw, and there's a long list of security flaws ever since. And they didn't think that was a problem. And that's not a small vendor, that's a really major vendor. And again, is your system patched? I did incline think about just putting is it patched on every single side on this, but we just keep emphasizing it. Everything needs to be patched. How long does it take to get your systems patched? Okay, so now we've got a huge pile of preamble out of the way. Now we can do some actual threat modeling. Okay. So this is one that I like just because it's such a bad example. It's not directly relevant to this audience, but I think you'll see why. So this was in the news recently. It was a protocol vulnerability called Crack in Wi-Fi, and it made the national news, and it made it. And basically, the gist of it was that if an attacker was on your Wi-Fi network and they used this attack, they could read the traffic on your network, as long as it wasn't encrypted with something else, like HTTPS over the top. And the reporting on it was shocking. So almost all Wi-Fi connections in the world has been hacked. Now, if you go back to the definitions that we used earlier, hopefully you'll see the problem here. This is a vulnerability. It's not been attacked. Slightly better, a huge hole in Wi-Fi security leaves just about everyone at risk. Okay, so we allow for a bit of hyperbole in the headline there. That's better. But then it says, this could be the Armageddon of the internet. It's like, no, guys, no, it couldn't. But you can break it down and say, okay, so what do you need to do? See, it's quite skilled, and you've got to be on the network to do it. So who's going to do it? Computer science students, electronic students. Are they going to do it? No, probably not, because we'll kick them off their course if they do it. So should you panic? No. It's just another vulnerability that we get some patches for, and we apply the patches, and we all move on with our lives. But that wasn't the way it was reported. And so this sort of threat modeling framework provides you a really nice way of looking at this sort of stuff. Okay, so let's pick a somewhat better example. So we have an application, I'm sure most of you will have something similar, that lets a student log in and update their bank account details that we've got on file so that we can send them bursaries and student loans and hardship funds and all the other bits of money that we send to them. Now, why would anyone want to attack that? Well, yeah, it's blindingly obvious, isn't it? Who's going to attack that? Well, criminals. And why are they going to do it? Because they want to steal some money. This is very much a live attack. People are doing this against universities. Universities have lost quite reasonable amounts of money doing this. And it's not just students, it's staff salaries as well. I had a report that some professors had had their salary stolen and hadn't noticed for several months, which just boggles the mind. Most of us are going to notice. Okay, so that's one bit of the threat model that's really easy in this case. The NSA aren't interested. We don't have to worry about the single £400 guy in his basement because we're assuming that he's less skilled than the criminals. So we'll just worry about the criminals and base your threat model on that attack scenario. So let's do some scenarios. So first one, student rings up in tears. They haven't got any money. They haven't got anywhere to sleep. They're going to be homeless. They're a young girl. They're going to be out in the streets. They might get raped. Now, I think all of us will have systems in place for this. How do you identify a student when they ring up over the phone? We've all got that, hopefully, pretty much sorted off, some way of doing it. But let's change it a bit. Let's say it's a Chinese student, and let's say the person that's ringing up is from the recruitment agency in China that placed them into your university. They will have all of that student's details. They will have had the student's password probably initially, but let's assume for the sake of argument the student's actually changed their password. Can you do verification well enough to defend against that attack? Now, obviously at one level you can just say, well, we're not going to do it unless you turn up in person with a passport, and we'll take your picture and we'll compare it to the passport and we'll do a whole bunch of things. And that comes back to the ATM example. Yeah. You can make it 100% secure if you want, or you can certainly make it very, very secure, 99% secure, unless you're going to get into passport forgery. But you're going to really annoy and inconvenience all your users. So where do you draw that line, and what data do you use? And if you use things like security reset questions, so if you've got some questions that you can ask them, you know, what was your mother's maiden name? Well, that's rubbish. What was the date of birth? That's bad. What was your best friend in school? Well, what happens if an attacker is motivated enough to friend this person on Facebook? How far do you want to go? So there's no right answer here. You just have to think about the options and decide what your risk level is. Oh, and the other thing, of course, there's nothing technical about this. Nothing at all. It's just pure social engineering, and I'm sure we'll get, in the next talk, examples of that. This is how it's generally happening at the moment. Somebody phishes the student, steals the password, and just changes their bank account details. Bonus marks, if the attacker knows enough, they'll try and do it just before the payment is due, so that there's the least time for the attack to be reverted before the money leaves, and then they'll take the money. So what can you do about that? You can try training. You can try and train people about phishing. We did a phishing exercise on the IT staff in the university. It didn't go well. It really didn't go well. So I think the hope for students is just less. So they're probably always going to get phished. And it, again, when you're threat modeling and you're thinking about this, a good assumption is probably to be that some number of students are always going to get phished. So what can you do about it? Next one. Attackers running a botnet, say. They get lucky and the admin of your finance system or some of the system-level admins on your finance system, they get malware on that PC. They get remote access to that PC. That's really bad. We tend to think these days of, oh, it's just a virus. Just run some AV. Let's just re-image the PC. Let's move on. If they put a password logger on this, they could have stolen huge numbers of passwords. You might not even notice for a long time. Obvious mitigations, you run AV, won't detect everything. Do you go as far as something as Microsoft ATP? The cloud, so Microsoft have this service where you run their endpoint AV, they upload it all to the cloud and they do lots of fancy heuristics and then machine learning and other stuff, and then we'll tell you whether you've got a virus. It's really, really good. It costs a lot of money. Is it worth spending that money? You have to decide. But probably when that decision is made moment, this sort of thing doesn't really get factored in, and that's certainly our problem. And then the final one is actually the sort of thing that you might think about as hacking. Yeah. There is a technical vulnerability in an application that's been written, and somebody hacks into that by typing code and doing some stuff, and it talks to the finance system and they steal some money. That's obviously bad, and you need to think about how to mitigate it, and you think about your software development, but in practice, no one's going to bother doing that, because they're just going to do that, because it's a lot easier. Okay, so what are some fixes? Patch, change default passwords, ban weak passwords, have the system penetration tests. Those are not so much defending against, well, certainly the first three, are not so much defending against the criminal attacker as just keeping out the riffraff. Protecting you against the automated attacks and the crypto lockers and the WannaCry worms of this world, and they're just the basics that you have to do. Have the system pen tested. If you've written any code, if this is a custom app, I would definitely do that. We now, instead of having the auditors turn up and look at our Microsoft AD and tell us that we've got no password aging policies on our AD, and we go and explain to them that we don't store password policies in AD, we do it somewhere else, we actually use internal audit time to get pen testing done. And that's been brilliant because we get sort of 15 days of pen testing for essentially free because it comes out of the audit budget. Highly recommended. Another load of problems just to think about for a minute. How do you identify students? We've talked about that one. Who has access to that data? Yeah. How tightly controlled is that data? How does your password reset process work again? And how long will it take a student to notice whatever change the attacker has done? Another set of mitigations. We can stick to paper. It's a lot more secure. It solves you all sorts of archiving problems as long as you've got a big room to put it on. Paper is great, so let's do that. You can keep this application only accessible from your VPN. In one sense, this is security by obscurity, because if the attacker has the user's password, so I've stolen the student's username and password, I can log on to the VPN, and then I can log on to the banking app. In practice, it does actually seem to be useful. However, it will also stop lots and lots of your students from connecting. Again, trade-off. Two-factor authentication. So as well as your username and password, you get a message on your phone, you have to do something. That will stop the phishing. This is great. But the user support costs are horrible. You know, what happens when people lose their phone? They've forgotten their phone. They can't work it. They don't want to put a university application on their personal device because that's interfering with their personal life. And how do you deal with all that stuff? So I know some universities are doing this for all authentications, and I'm very happy to let them do it first and then hopefully learn from what they've done. The next one is what we actually do for our bank account app. So we've got a record of student phone numbers, and it turns out that data is actually pretty good. We thought initially that it might be rubbish, but actually it's pretty good. So student logs in, they change their bank account, they instantly get a text message. And that works because the text message is out of bounds to email. So the attacker will have access to their emails. There's no point in emailing them. But if you send them an SMS, if you've changed your bank account, you just get a nice message that confirms you've done what you want. And you think, oh, that's good, it's gone through. If you just get a message that says your bank account's changed, you haven't done anything, you'll panic and run at high speed to IT support, which is exactly what we want to happen. And that costs a few hundred quid a year. And we send quite a lot of text messages. It's really cheap. Training for the help desk. Not necessarily the IT help desk here. This might be your student frontline support. It might be your admissions team. You know, all around, how do you identify people? What do you do? How do you deal with distressed students while still politely verifying their identity? How far do you go? One that would be nice but is really hard to do and we don't do, expose where the student is logging in from. So trigger an alert. If someone's logging in from Nigeria and they were on campus yesterday, flag that one for manual review. Don't automatically push it through. It's just in practice it's quite hard to do because you can log into all sorts of systems in all sorts of different ways and we don't have that data centrally. But that would be really nice. Final couple of slides. I quite like this. The idea that data should have a half-life and you should delete data. That if you keep it forever, it will be lost and therefore you shouldn't keep it forever. Certainly we're really bad at this. GDPR is obviously going to help with this because we're going to have data life cycles and justify how we're going to keep our data. So it will actually give us a security benefit to do all this work for GDPR. Very final aside, metrics, what should you measure? So the one thing you shouldn't measure is number of breaches, or at least you should measure it and not think about it too much. If you're getting lots of breaches, that's a bad sign and you should do something about it, clearly. If you're getting no breaches, that doesn't really mean a lot. It might mean you're Fort Knox and no one's hacked into you. It might mean you haven't noticed and you've been hacked 73 ways from Sunday. You can't tell. So you should track it but not read too much into it. Naught is probably a bad number here. Naught just means you're not noticing. As I mentioned, you should talk about uptime, time to patch. You know, when your database vendor releases a critical patch, how long does it take you to get it onto your live and your test and your development systems, all of them, all the way through? It's probably quite a long time. Is that okay? Probably. But at least think about it consciously. You can think about the percentage of systems that have been pen tested. It'll probably be quite a low number unless you've got lots of money. But it's still probably a useful metric to track. And certainly, you could subdivide your applications into super critical things like a banking app where you probably do want them all pen tested and the rest of them. Percentage of your staff that have been security trained, another good thing to think about. Finally, because we've been talking about people that just want to make money, I'll basically leave you with this hopefully obvious analogy here. You don't have to be good. You just have to be less rubbish than everybody else. So, there we go. Questions?
Right. Thank you, Arthur. I'm afraid we don't have time for questions at the moment, but I'm sure if anybody wants to catch Arthur afterwards, then
be around.
So we break for coffee now.